Yes, we have quite a busy panel and quite a short amount of time, so we will get stuck in. Just a reminder to everyone that it is being live streamed, and if you have questions, put your hand up, and I'm sure our panelists will be delighted to answer you. So, net neutrality planet, what is next in the global fight for an open internet? It's a huge topic, so we will try to do justice to it. But let me start by, I will start at this end and introduce our panel. We have Julie Owono, who is the executive director of the lawyer, a lawyer for Internet Sans Frontières. Then next to there, we have Matt Wood, policy director, Free Press in the US. Cynthia Koo, who is also another lawyer. To my right, Thomas Leuninger, who is the executive director of Epicenter Works and put this panel together. And then last but not least, Savjit Singh, who is the program manager at the Center for Communication Governance at the National Law University in Delhi. So let's start then with you at this end and sort of briefly explain your experience with net neutrality.
Hi, I'm Saravjit. So with a lot of you must have heard the Indian experience and stuff, and India has become like sort of the poster child for the fight against net neutrality in the past couple of years. And just to give you a very like run through of what basically happened, in late 2014, one of the biggest telcos basically wanted to bring like separate packs to use VoIP services, and they wanted to charge separately, and that's where I think the whole movement started, and Kiran's here. So Kiran's part of the Save the Internet Foundation, which started all this. So Kiran got together with a couple of other friends and all, and the entire movement was raised. So the regulator came out with the paper, and yeah, the regulator basically came out with the paper asking for different solutions. And what was most surprising that this was one of the like the most massive grassroots movements by citizens. So over a million people, like over a million people submitted comments to the regulators asking for no net neutrality, asking for net neutrality and saying that free basics and all shouldn't be allowed. And I think what was most exciting about the order that you see, because the a lot of like debates and stuff that were coming out from Facebook and other people were like that a lot of people don't have internet access and this would provide them internet access. The order very categorically mentions that if like the people who don't have access have to be provided the entire access, because otherwise whatever the limited access is, that'll shape their view. And it also specifically said, so in India, like ICCPR, we have a right to freedom of expression under Article 19 of our constitution, and it specifically said that stuff like free basics or differential pricing would violate the Article 19 of the constitution. So those were the two like very interesting things that came out of the order, and I think the general story a lot more or less everyone has heard about what's been happening.
Okay, Thomas.
Yeah, so what happened in Europe? We were fighting as a society for net neutrality for many years. More or less after the US started the debate, we also had two laws, first in Netherlands and afterwards in Slovenia. But we always wanted a European solution because that's the level at which you should cement net neutrality. And in September 2013, the Commission proposed a law which would basically abandon net neutrality. And then we started the campaign SaveTheInternet.eu, had a huge mobilization. There were seven different versions of that website over a three-year process, which ultimately led to quite a good net neutrality law that we have now in Europe and a good regulatory implementation. That's also what sets Europe a little bit apart, that we actually have a law and it was not just the regulator coming up with rules. And right now, we have more or less a good protection. There are still a few things ambiguous. For example, zero rating. The Indian solution to that problem is much better and much clearer. And yeah, but we keep on fighting. So the Safety Internet Coalition still exists. We are now working mostly on enforcing net neutrality, so basically making sure that the regulators do their job to actually enforce net neutrality. And we see a very interesting picture of a broad spectrum of willingness of NRAs, of regulators, to actually do their job. And on the other side, we have a constant debate about 5G, about the new standard for mobile networks. And operators are using this new standard to fight and push against net neutrality and are quite successful to get politicians to adopt their language and also say, yeah, we need 5G, and maybe we need to water down net neutrality, That's why the fight is still not over.
Okay, Cynthia. I mean, it's a pity we don't have a regulator on the panel, but...
Hi, my name is Cynthia, and most of my work in net neutrality has been in Canada, which is where I'm from. The majority of that has been as external counsel to Open Media, which is an international digital rights organization that's headquartered in Vancouver, BC. So just for some background context, Canada's current net neutrality rules were established in 2009 by our communications regulator, which is the CRTC, the Canadian Radio, Television, and Telecommunications Commission. And what it says is you're allowed to manage internet traffic through pricing, so that's why we have things like data caps, but you're not allowed to manage traffic technically, and that's why things like blocking and throttling are pretty straightforwardly blocked unless you have to actively apply for permission from the regulator. And that was kind of the status quo for a while, but then last year, companies started trying to do things like zero rating. So the commission held a hearing, which Open Media intervened in towards the end of last year, and based on the regulator's behavior throughout that hearing, the decision hasn't come down yet, but we're hopeful. We ended up making it not just about zero rating, but about the whole idea of data caps as well and how legitimate those were. And we're looking forward to seeing that decision. It was supposed to come in the next couple months. But just last week, the federal government of Canada actually released their federal budget, and in it, they said they were going to open up a review of the Telecommunications Act and Broadcasting Act. And so that's actually making some of us nervous in the Canadian digital rights community, because it sounds like things are going to be on the table again, and that's going to be an opportunity for a lot of loopholes to be introduced. So that's going to keep us on our toes for the next little while.
The U.S. perspective, then.
So, yes, hello. I'm greetings from the land of Donald Trump, where I work, I think, three blocks from the White House. Kind of the same story with that bizarre twist to it that we've heard about from the other nations and continents. We've had a decade and a half of fighting over this issue, and in 2014, and leading into the decision in early 2015, won a very resounding victory that we thought would perhaps settle the matter for the next little while. Lo and behold, Donald Trump is elected, and the entire government switches hands. Our legislature is controlled both chambers by the same party as Donald Trump. I don't think it's a very simple story. I mean, I think if people have followed the healthcare debate in the US at all, this is actually kind of similar. About the only thing uniting the Republican Party right now is that they want to change the net neutrality law in some way. Some say we should keep it, but we should change the legal framework. Others say we should get rid of it. It's a terrible idea in the beginning. They really don't agree with each other. About the only thing they agree about is that they don't like us and that they want to somehow dismantle the decision that was handed down in 2015 and then upheld by our court system just last year. So a lot of twists and turns, and as Cynthia was saying and others were saying, you know, this is both a decade and a half of fighting now and something that is in the daily headlines every day and on the front page, because we still don't know exactly when and where they will move next. We just had a big vote on privacy this week and last week. And that's certainly feeding into the same question and the same kind of debates, but exactly when they will try to dismantle net neutrality, either at the regulatory agency or in our legislature or through some other combination of those things, we're still not sure, and we're just trying to prepare for all of those various attacks.
Okay. Well, as far as West and Central Africa are concerned, where we work most, all this is really an elitist preoccupation. I mean, people need to access to internet, and right? So, that's not my opinion, but I'm just trying to summarize what the issue is like at the moment. So the priority is really about getting people online. So that's the priority from the government, most governments. So that explained why, for instance, there are many zero rating services in countries like Senegal, for instance, where Tigo and Facebook have partnered to offer free internet, I mean, internet.org services. And that's why also, yes, the internet.org has been so popular and has not been questioned or stopped by any government, because really the emergency right now is to have more people online at the lowest cost possible, because affordability, and that's where it's interesting to discuss here, affordability is the major issue and access. So that's where we are.
Well, let me take your point then, that you have different issues. I mean, do you feel that there's a sense that sort of places where we think the battle is won, more or less, like Europe, or we thought it was won, like the US, exports its model to Africa or to other parts of the world?
Well, You mean on the debate on net neutrality, yeah. Right? I don't. In my opinion, it's not. It's a kind of hypocritical argument. Why? Because we believe at our organization and many other organizations working on the continent, we believe that there is no reason that the internet that has allowed creativity to be unleashed 20, 15, 10 years ago in Europe, in the US and elsewhere, should not be the same and unleash the same creativity in the next frontier of internet, and specifically in this case, the African continent. So it's not about exporting a model, it's just about a principle that should be applied equally everywhere, if that's what internet is about, equality for everyone. So the argument on the elitism of this preoccupation, I would say, is short-sighted. It's really about equality making the most of the internet for everyone. Either you're poor peasant in the suburb of Yaoundé, Cameroon, or whether you are a business holder in the city in London. So yes.
And Matt, do you want to?
Yeah, I mean, I think I would say largely the same thing. Now, in the U.S. right now, we don't really have the luxury anymore of having the zero rating debate because we were starting to have it, and then the administration changed, and now we're almost back to square one and fighting over a more basic level of protections, or even just the question, should there be a role for non-discrimination rights online that the government has some power to enforce? But I do think it's important to note what Julie said. I don't think there's a one-size-fits-all approach to either halves of this question. You know, non-discrimination is important. Access is incredibly important. Without access to the internet, you know, the rights that we enjoy there are pretty meaningless to people who aren't online today. So at least at our organization, we always try to be very careful around this and not suggest that there's a one-size-fits-all approach to either part of the question, just that there are ways to get past what I guess I would call a false dichotomy and a false choice, that you can have either one or the other. You can either have affordable access or non-discriminatory access, but never the two combined. At least in the US, we don't believe the math on that. We don't believe the carriers who say you have to choose. And I think that that has been borne out by the way that our market and our broadband services have evolved and basically gone swimmingly along since the net neutrality decision came down. You know, there were a lot of predictions of doom and gloom and investment will crumble and the internet will be changed forever for the worse, and we have not seen that. We've seen investment continue to go up and revenues for the telecom providers to go up. So that's where we basically want to call foul, at least on the U.S. providers who've tried to make a version of that argument that you can't really have both rights at the same time.
I just thought it was really interesting, the framing that this is a model that's being exported, because I know a lot of people were trying to frame it that way, that this is almost a Western democratic concept that you're trying to bring from the outside into places like India and Africa, for example, and that completely ignores the fact that there are people on the ground who are asking for this. So it's not actually something that was made up in the United States or in Canada and then being imposed from the outside. It's something that the people there are also asking for, and it's more organic. It's not from the outside, so it's not actually being exported or imported. It's, as Julie mentioned, it's about principles applying across the board.
Okay, well, let me pick up on that and go straight then. You mentioned the grassroots in India. I mean, where did that come from? Because we do see it as quite an elitist, privileged position to worry about the quality of our internet when some people can't even get online at all.
So it was, I think, the campaign was mostly people like journalists, lawyers, different tech people got together, and it was mostly based on the Save the Internet in US and the EU campaign. And what I think really triggered, and what I think actually we should do, especially in Global South or like in developing countries, is people don't really understand net neutrality and the concept and why it is important. What really helped was a video by this really popular comedian group that happened, so something what like John Oliver did there. And that is, I think, where it just picked up. And I think in a period of like a couple of weeks and stuff, over 1 million people submitted, where I think the initial goal was like much less than that.
Well, Thomas, I mean, are we having different conversations in different parts of the world? Is that a danger? And is it a danger or is it a good thing?
I think net neutrality and digital rights in general, there is a certain logic out of the media. I mean, we're speaking with net neutrality not so much about something that has been invented in the US or in Europe. It is the foundational principle of the internet, born out of sheer technical necessity back then, when we had, didn't have the computational power to make real-time decisions about the legality or the importance of a data package while it was transmitted. But this technical decision also had a certain philosophical aspect of making a dumb network that just serves the endnodes. And innovations and decisions are made on the endnodes, which allows the application to grow and to spark diversity there. Now with specialized service, we have a little bit of a debate of putting intelligence back into the network and having access services which are optimized for certain applications. We really see no need for that, because even without net neutrality, if there would be innovation possible in that field, then nothing would have stopped ISPs to come up with great products in the last 25 years. But the opposite is true. We have a long, strong record of innovation happening in the open, free internet, and I think, therefore, politicians should also lay the stress and the protection on keeping the internet open.
I totally agree with what you just said about politicians and their role. This is something that is sadly lacking when it comes to a part of the world like Western Central Africa, is that the issue of, again, accessibility is completely left to the private sector, who is going to solve the issue, you know, come with their balloons and all their... It's great, really, but, I mean, it's a public utility also, internet, so it should be a preoccupation as well for government. So, obviously, if the private sector is only left, is left as the only, body or group or corporation that can understand and build the best services, of course, we are going to come up with such... going back on a lot of progress that were made, and it's not good. So that's why the understanding of the importance of net neutrality, not only by the users but most importantly by the politicians, letting them know that companies can earn even more money if more people create more value with an open and free internet for free in terms of. Freedoms, mm-hmm. Not free in terms of money, of course. I mean, that's another
that would
debate,
be nice,
but yes,
yeah.
It'd be nice, but of course, so yes, that's, the politician's role is very important.
I laughed when you talked about balloons, because you're probably talking about Facebook's plans and Elon Musk, and, but I imagined like party balloons, like, hey, we're here to save you, which they bring also to the party oftentimes. I think the Indian example, though, is just such a good example of how complex these issues really are, especially when you cross borders and cross oceans. It's almost like a meta-elitism debate, too, because there was something of an attack in the U.S. against U.S. advocates who were part of that debate, but we were an incredibly tiny part of it. And so the notion that, you know, people from anywhere else, U.S., EU, otherwise, came to India and said, you guys shouldn't like this, I think is a real disservice to people like Sarbjeet and others who were here who were working against this in the country. We were just trying to do our role to support that in any way we could by contributing what few people we have in India who are on our list and saying, hey, you should hear from these people about this issue. So I think it's almost like there's an old child saying, I know you are, but what am I? Like, you say we're being colonialist, but I think it's actually what's ignoring the organic and true grassroots energy and interest and understanding of this issue around the world. Not that there's any easy answer to it, but it's not something that is, you know, decided from net neutrality central and then handed on down to people around the world.
And to reiterate what Julie and Thomas said about innovation and about politicians, that actually really reminded me of something. One of my colleagues from Open Media, Ruth, I was speaking with her on a completely different topic, and she mentioned, why do we always say we're waiting for innovation when so often that really becomes waiting for business, waiting for private business? And we were talking about it in the context of journalism, but I think it applies in the context of internet access as well. If these are, as I think most of us would agree, unalloyed public goods and in the public interest, why would we leave something so important and so fundamental to the successes or failures of private business? And so even our regulator, actually in Canada, last year they held a hearing on universal basic service for Canada, and the regulator themselves paused the hearing midway to call on the Canadian federal government, saying we need a plan, we need to fix this problem, do something about it. And so I think really echoing that call to governments to recognize how fundamental this is and to do something about it is definitely something that we can keep putting more pressure on.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned regulators, because that was sort of my next question, which is, okay, you've won a battle, you've got a law. I mean, enforcement is obviously the next step. What is the situation in Europe at the moment, Thomas?
Quite diverse. I mean, we have the law, which was adopted in autumn of 2015, and then the regulators who have to enforce this law had came up with guidelines that more or less give them a clear picture of what does this law actually mean, how do you put it in practice. And on this step, we really had the mass mobilization from the grassroots with 500,000 comments that were submitted to the regulators, which if you compare it with the population size, is almost as good as India. We were really proud of that. And at the end now, there is an agreement within BEREC, the body of European regulators of electronic communications, but there are still the national independent regulators that have to do their job. And we see a great difference in for their approach, for example, zero rating. This is really an issue where we have not really won, because the law and the guidelines just say it's a case-by-case issue. And that means that in each and every case, you have to go through an economic analysis. If in this particular market, in this country, this ISP is really discriminating against a competitor, and only then can you apply those rules, which is a very strict reading that does not allow to really put the idea of net neutrality into practice, because it's not so much about competition, it's about allowing innovation. I only have the perspective of competition law, and I will never allow those innovative startups that have no lawyers at all to become big with their service, because they're just not in a position to make deals with every ISP whose customers they potentially want to reach, particularly not in the European context where the market is still so fragmented on the access level. Right now what we do is we have operations where we look at all the different violations of net neutrality. We have Respect My Net, which is a crowdsourcing platform where users can submit violations they come across. And then we look into those cases, we investigate them, we build up evidence, and then at the end we submit cases to the national regulators, which are very detailed in the technical evidence, in the legal analysis, and as far as we can do it, with very limited funding that we have, also with the economic analysis of like, okay, we work within this current telecom framework and really try to get the ball right so that those zero rating offers at the end will be prohibited. And there's another talk that I'll give about specifically this work that we do tomorrow at 5:15.
India, the regulation, and I think what we need to understand about the Indian context is, though the debate, people say it's about net neutrality, the regulations were on a very specific issue, like only on price differentiation, and that is completely banned, and it, like, the regulations provide for very high like fees or fines, like if the telecom regulators do it, and it's also for a limited period of 2 years. So initially it's for 2 years, and they've said they'll revisit it in 2 years. And I think in that context, whatever happens in other parts of the world, and I think especially like in US and Europe, would actually affect that and how they come to it after 2 years. The other thing that might be interesting, so what's happening in India now is the regulator is now dealing with other issues of like paid prioritization and other stuff. And there they have specifically asked for comments on issues like how do you measure violations and stuff. And depending on what the guidelines are, I think that'll be a good case study to look at.
Okay. Have we any questions in the room? Does anyone want to tackle our panelists on anything in particular? No? Okay. Yeah, yes. There's a microphone here just at the front. You can grab it.
Hey, my name is Peter Teffer. I'm a journalist with EU Observer based here in Brussels. And I guess one question for the only European on a panel and then one to the others. You've already mentioned BEREC and that you're looking at some of the enforcement. Can you elaborate a little bit more on what are the different interpretations that you see? And I remember that when it was voted on in Parliament, you basically had one group of people who said, yes, we'll have net neutrality, and you have another group who says, no, we don't have anything. What's your view on that? How has that played out? Mm-hmm. And to the rest of you all, how have you looked at this discussion in Europe, and do you feel like are you confident that there is now net neutrality in Europe, or do you see some problems there? Thanks.
So one big differentiation is on the issue of zero rating, because that's really where they have not really reached an agreement in this guideline process on the barrack level. And we recently had a decision in Sweden which allowed basically Facebook zero rating of the Facebook access with the biggest incumbent Telia in Sweden. And that is as bad for competition as it could get, because of course Facebook has a huge market share in Europe. Telia is the biggest mobile operator in Sweden, but still this product was allowed. Contrary, on the other line of the spectrum, you recently also had a decision by the Hungarian regulator that prohibited also zero-rated service with, where you could buy application-specific data volume. So you would no longer buy a few gigabytes of internet, but a few gigabytes or megabytes of video streaming or social media. And whatever then qualifies as social media or video streaming is left to the ISP to decide. And I think there we will have a continuous discussion that hopefully also reaches the barrack level. And what's also great about barrack is that it's actually quite factual-based decision. Although certain operators have restrictions in their freedom of movement, particularly if they try to regulate the incumbent, you know, where the company, where the government is still holding shares, and there is a certain hesitancy to do something which would restrict their revenues. And yeah, the other big issue is that specialized services are also something where the law is was quite ambiguous, and the barrack guidelines really solved the issue. They really came down on the pro-net neutrality side, saying that it is actually about the service that you offer, not just the quality assurance that you give to a user. In the latter case, you could just say, this is Skype crystal clear, and I guarantee you that it will be of high quality, and therefore you suddenly have a specialized service for Skype, for example. And so this debate will come back, particularly now with the 5G debate and with the quite frightening appeal that this seems to have to most governments. So instead of investing in a network, they think with 5G it will just solve itself. And we need regulatory holidays, we need to step back on net neutrality, and then operators will have the revenues to invest in 5G instead of real fiber infrastructure that will solve the problem long term.
Since you asked, I mean, I think I can weigh in only to say that I can't really weigh in. Oftentimes in the US we hear these comparisons made to the EU or anywhere else, and they're really self-centered. You know, it's like speeds in Europe are so much faster / slower because their regulations are so much better / worse, and it kind of depends on who's making the argument. So we always defer to people who are living it and experiencing it, working in those countries or living there or both. I do think, though, that there is some truth to everything Thomas said, of course, but the different enforcement structures across different countries. You know, so if I were to weigh in, I would probably say, is there net neutrality in Europe? It probably depends on which country you're in, despite the similarities and the common framework across it all.
At least there is a debate that goes just beyond the EU institutions. I mean, actors were involved, other actors were involved in a consultation. There was a consultation process. That is something which I would like to stress on, which is very important. Which is related to educate, you know, broader public on why net neutrality is important. I was fascinated to see, to receive some, you know, petitions or information about this consultation, because I knew that this kind of things would never happen in the near future in a country such as mine, such as Cameroon, because clearly we probably as civil society have not done our job yet of passing the knowledge, I mean, at least giving information on the good and the good and bad things with net neutrality. Because there are also, you know, I receive, when I try to advocate for it, I receive arguments such as, yes, but you do have internet, so for you it's an issue, it becomes an issue, so we should also take this into account. But really, what's fascinating is the ability to have a debate on this quite technical issue, we have to admit it, but nevertheless very important for the future of the infrastructure.
So largely from the Canadian perspective on the BEREC rules, I think a lot of it is the same as what Matt said as well. But two things he said interested were interesting is the first one is, I believe, that they combined the minimum service requirements within the net neutrality rules, and I found that we were also looking at the BEREC rules to figure out if this is something we should do as well, and it seemed good because we had these as two separate proceedings. We had the minimum service quality universal service hearing, and then later we had the net neutrality zero rating hearing, and it almost seemed like if you combined them, there just seemed a distant risk that they would almost be used to undermine and weaken each other, where, for instance, they would say, well, we have minimum service quality, so if we're above that, then it's fine, we can zero rate. Or the other way around, if we can zero rate, then that might detract them from actually investing in that basic infrastructure and raising the level for everyone across the board. So that was the first thing. The second thing about 5G, that was also interesting because during our zero rating hearing last year, one of the companies, they did something very similar but with Internet of Things as opposed to 5G. They said, well, we have to allow zero rating because what about the Internet of Things? We might break it if we don't do zero rating. It may never have happened. So whereas it's almost an argument for the way around, right? Would we have IoT if it weren't for net neutrality and all of these things being able to happen in terms of innovation at the edge and things like that. So it was interesting to see that parallel, and maybe that's something we should be on the lookout for, is that kind of derail of almost holding these other innovations hostage to what would actually be principles that may be better for them rather than worse.
I love the Internet of Things example, though, too, because to dive into the weeds for a second but quickly come back out, our communications law is called, it's Title II of the Communications Act that's the basis for the net neutrality rules, and that's what we want in court. And so I've had arguments with people who say, well, what do you mean Internet of Things should apply in Title II and these communications laws should apply to the Internet of Things? Do you think that your refrigerator should be subject to Title II? And I said, well, that depends. Do you think phone calls to a refrigerator repair person should be subject to communications laws, or do you think it's somehow different? You know, it's not the object itself, it's not the thing on the internet that is subject to communications laws and these non-discrimination questions. It is the connectivity that allows that thing to be connected in the first place. And I think that's what gets lost as people sort of get mystified by the technological changes and don't understand the commonality, which is the communications network that ties it all together.
Okay, any more questions? Okay, so do you take on Peter's question?
In India, I think we looked at it quite closely and we were a bit, not surprised, but I think not very happy about the zero rating stuff because they said it's on a case-by-case basis. And after the Indian example, I think especially because they look at it after 2 years, a lot of like telcos and like other companies might use that in 2 years and say that let's do it in on a case-by-case basis till you can actually show harm. But otherwise, I think it's mostly been used very favorably. Like the current paper that I was discussing, that actually quotes a lot of stuff from the ruling, then specifically says stuff like on fast lanes and stuff, and says that Europe has done this and whether we should do this and if we should, what should be the way, like whether we should just copy it or if it should be separate or not.
Well, let's move a bit. Yeah.
I wanted to add a point. So just to add to what Sarvjit just said, TRAI made the ruling in February 2016 and said 2 years. It's been 13 months since. So we only have 11 months left of that rule. In between, they issued another order that talked about free data and created a concept called a data aggregator that essentially turns data into currency minted by a telco, which is dangerous. It's going to cause a huge bunch of problems. Now, the thing is that they don't have the power to actually enforce it. It has to go up to the Department of Telecom. If that comes through and the 2 year sunset expires next year, we actually have serious trouble ahead of us. You know, that we need to start work on making sure things are clear by next year.
Yeah, well, I think Thomas said at the beginning, the fight is never over. But I want to move on a little bit from this sort of the zero rating, because that gets all the headlines. I mean, what are the other issues we should be looking at, you know, like volume caps, that sort of thing, Thomas?
Yeah, that's actually good that you say it, because, I mean, it brings me back to something that Cynthia was saying. At the end, the reason why ISPs want to restricted neutrality are two things. One is they see how much money other companies make with their customers over their network and they want a piece of the cake. So the classical vertical integration. I see how much money Google makes and that's happening in my network and so I want a piece of the cake. Or in different variation, Netflix uses up so much of the volume that my users use. And Netflix is responsible for so much traffic in my network. And they're completely blind to the fact that those over-the-top services, as they are called, are the reason why there is demand for internet in the first place. Because without those services, people probably would not upgrade their internet connection and would still use modems. And second thing is that if you are in a framework where you would need to invest in your infrastructure, and in most European countries that's the case, and I think all around the globe, we don't have the fiber network that we need to be on the safe side for the next century. You have the decision of whether you spend millions to invest in your network or you monetize the scarcity. And you try to reshuffle the little bandwidth or the little volume that you give your users. And then, of course, when you have a certain scarcity, if there is a problem to provide a service in an adequate quality to the users of this provider, you can start asking for money in order to exempt them of the scarcity. And these are the two driving forces, I think, that are universal from the telecoms perspective, why we even have those debates. And I think there are really good arguments that are quite clear, to me at least, why this is not the right way forward.
Well, there's a very interesting video and explainer on this. It's called Using Aeroplane Boarding to Explain Net Neutrality. If you haven't seen it, you should watch it. I've just tweeted the link to it while they were talking, so you can find it at Brussels Geek on Twitter. But I mean, let me play devil's advocate for a moment and say, but I'm a big company. I've put all this investment into infrastructure. Why should you tell me what I can and can't sell to consumers?
Yeah, I mean, I don't have a much different answer than we just heard, which is that they actually make money when they keep it open. Right. You know, I mean, so one thing that we did in the last couple of years is we opposed the suggested merger between Comcast and Time Warner Cable, two of our biggest broadband providers. Eventually, Time Warner Cable was bought out by another company, so we have a lot of consolidation, but at least that deal didn't go through. And what we showed in our opposition to that deal was we almost had this perfect match between the lines. One was the growth in Netflix subscribership and revenues, and the other was the growth in Comcast revenues. And so it really is this notion that you like to fight with each other, and the notion of bandwidth hogs and people, you know, they shouldn't be allowed to use my pipes for free. I mean, it's a little bit simplistic, but not really very much, to say that everybody benefits when the network stays open. And this is not just a fight between big companies who are fighting over how much money they can make. It really is about empowering users to drive that engine forward.
I have a question though on this. Are there any studies that you know, try to evaluate how much a company could make more, a telco company could make more? I don't know if that's a question I'm asking. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, just really quickly to that point, I don't know. It's funny because in the U.S., at least up until the change in government, most of the companies have said, well, we would never do the blocking. We would never do paid prioritization. You know, now that question is live again. But for a little while, at least, they were saying, oh, we don't want to make that money that we theoretically could make or that we used to claim we would make. So they were willing to leave that on the table if there's any real money there. And I don't know the answer either, what they might claim and what the reality might be. Maybe two different things.
Yes. Well, we have a question from the back. Cynthia, you can speak while we pass the microphone back here.
Sure. Okay, I just had all these thoughts come up as everyone was speaking, so there's a slight backlog now. With respect to the studies on...
You need traffic management for that.
So the studies on what happened, I don't know how relevant this is. I know there was a Free Press report that showed that investment actually increased due to the net neutrality rules in the United States, which is very interesting. But in terms of the cost itself, this is something I feel like this is the missing link in terms of telecom and net neutrality regulation, is how much does it actually cost to transport a megabit, to transport a gigabit. If we knew that, so much would be solved. So that there's that. And then to your question as to, we're a private company, why should he tell us what to sell or how to sell it? I have three responses to that. So,
not really me.
So the first one is, it's true, you're a private company, but you're a company, but you had public support, especially telecommunications companies, telephone companies who used to have government subsidies just to get started. You have all of that public support. You depend on cities for rights of way. There are all these things that the government has set up and that public funding has helped you to do to make your company successful, if not to build it up to begin with. So there's that aspect. The second aspect of it is that you're not just any company, you're a regulated company. So there's a reason that there are regulators set up to impose rules, because even if you're not completely a legal utility the same way an electricity company is, you're almost substantively the way that people think of you, the way that people use you. So this isn't a lollipop shop, for instance, where you can do whatever you want because there's more competition. It's your telecommunications company. People rely on you for a fundamental aspect of their everyday life, which leads to the third point, that even if there weren't hard laws and regulations around it, it kind of just comes with the territory. If you've made yourself so important to people's lives, you have that power of being something that people rely on every single day, then I don't see why you shouldn't also have the responsibility of living up to being that thing that people rely on every single day.
Okay. The question? Yeah.
Hi. I'm Mate from Apti. I wanted to actually answer your question.
Okay.
And my response to this question, why should someone tell me what to do with my own investment? And I think this, the reason why this conversation, this debate has been, let's say lost to the opponents of net neutrality in particular in the US, was that the reasoning put forward was very much human rights based, very much public duty based, instead of going to the heart of the problem, because the opponents of net neutrality in the US are conservatives, are financial conservatives, looking very much, for them, the right of to private property is of greater importance than the other human rights. I think that both should be on the same plane, but in reality, that's not really the case. So I would say, okay, why should you tell me how to use my infrastructure? The thing is that you're already an artificial monopoly because of the regulation of the country where you're operating. Because in order to be able to conduct business, you have to you have these responsibilities. But because usually the rights of way legislation restricts easy deployment of new networking infrastructure. Mm-hmm. You are essentially being given a monopoly by the state. Okay, you play by their rules, but you also get something which no one else can get. And if you want to go the regulatory way, then you should keep it fair, you know, fair and square. Yeah? You give something, but you get something, but you give something back. Otherwise, we could go the other way. So, okay, you lose your monopoly. We create legislation for rights of way, for the right of way, allowing pretty much everybody to easily create networks. And at that point, it becomes purely a competition problem, but you don't have a monopoly anymore. And you'll be the one who loses, because once competitors can enter your market, they will all flock to the new ones because they hate you already.
Well, possibly. Okay, so it's quite a long-winded response, but I think the point is that, but there's different levels of monopoly and competition in different parts of the world, and we shouldn't just assume it is a one monopoly system, because do you want to tell me about the Indian experience?
Based on the discussion, so what India has done and the way our market is structured, like it's mostly mobile-based, so the fixed mm-hmm. line there are not as much, and most of people use there. And the way the regulators and courts have like interpreted it, they have said that the spectrum is a public resource. And so based on this discussion, they've said, and it has to be used, you have to make sure that it's used to like provide diversity of media and information. And that's like a specific ruling by the Indian Supreme Court. So I think that has helped a lot in the context of net neutrality and stuff for us.
Yeah. I'd also like to weigh in there. At the end, net neutrality is a question about distribution. If we would have no scarcity, if we would have fiber connection everywhere and on every household, on every mobile connection, you have symmetric gigabits, maybe we would not talk about net neutrality anymore. But the reality is that we have restrictions, particularly in mobile, particularly when it comes to volumes, which is also why I think the Canadian way to move the zero rating debate to a debate about why do we still have volume caps is exactly the right approach. And we had this also in the European debate because Sweden was a fierce critic of net neutrality, and together with the British, like our fiercest opponent within Barrack. And in Sweden, you have in many ways a really good telecommunications market with structural separation. So like you have community fiber, and then you have a range of ISPs that compete, but they don't own the infrastructure, which is actually, in my opinion, the optimal model. But still, there are problems for net neutrality in Sweden. We've mentioned the net neutrality case there, that the incumbent Telia has a zero rating deal with Facebook. This directly affects the Swedish consumers and the majority of them that are with Telia. And so I think there is definitely still the need, even in those markets where there's a better competition and everything, to look for those violations. Because And Neelie Kroes, the former commissioner for digital affairs in Europe, always made this argument. If you don't like the net neutrality practice of your ISP, then vote with your feet and just go to another provider. Often you cannot do that. Often you're locked in a contract, and an ISP always has the termination monopoly. What does this mean? The ISP has the monopoly of reaching you. When I'm a startup and I want to serve a service to you, and your ISP blocks or throttles me, or zero rates my competitor, this affects our relationship. And so competition is really not the right way to look at the net neutrality problem.
Yeah, and I like a lot of the answer from the audience, but I think just two points to push back on. I wouldn't say they're entirely artificial monopolies. At least in the US, we've had now 2 decades plus of experiments with trying to get a second and third wire into the market rather than regulating the first one. And it hasn't really worked. I mean, Google, a little tiny company called Google, tried to make a go of it and is now essentially pressed pause, I think, is the corporate euphemism for the way they have decided to not roll out in quite as many cities as they'd hoped to. So I think there's some natural monopoly tendencies here, too. And the second point is, I talked about innovation, great buzzword, very corporate, but you know, the fact that this actually is a good business proposition for all parties involved, I think we have tried to do that, use both the human rights and the property rights frames. I guess the point I always try to make back is that if you're pro-business, are you going to be pro the one business who sells internet access or the million that buy it? And so I think a property rights and a pro-business attitude doesn't have to mean pro-monopoly. There are far more businesses that buy internet access rather than those who just sell it.
Okay, have any other comments from the room before I ask Julie to talk a little bit about the different markets in Africa, because it's not one market. And in particular, this question of mobile infrastructure versus fixed?
Well, fixed infrastructure, doesn't even exist because I don't have the precise figures, but there are some countries where 98% of the internet market is mobile. So this is not, and when it comes to competition in some countries, you don't have much choice either. in terms of net neutrality issues, for now, users are trapped, and there's a lot to do. This is something we're trying to do, that is to say, build bridges between thinkers and activists here who have already been through it all, I would almost say, and who already know what could come next in terms of cyber development, because they've seen what happened in the EU or in the US, and actually discuss with civil society there, with consumer associations. They are really, really, really strong on the African continent, but it's just that in the telecom industry, they don't have a lot of knowledge. So that's something that could be built here, that bridge with this civil society there, and also, yes, you've done a lot of perspective here. I'm hearing discussions here that I barely heard in other contexts, and specifically in the African context. So these are discussions that should be also taken in those new markets, because these are issues that we will have to deal with, or maybe we won't have time to deal with if we don't anticipate on them now, and we'll have a flawed internet market developing. It's already really flawed because, as I was saying, I have nothing against Facebook, but internet.org is present in more than 30 countries in Africa when it was kicked out in India. We have exactly the same problem. We need to connect the population. So why was it run in India, and why is it better for Africans? There's a problem there. So I think it's really a question of building bridges and building knowledge on that, you know, and getting inspiration from what you did in India and having some perspective from what happened in the EU and what will come next, because although we are still at the 4G and 3G levels, 5G will soon probably become an issue as well in Africa, so yes.
Okay, well, let me put my company hat back on again then and say, well, you know, okay, you regulate us, that's fine, but you can't set limits or give me rules on traffic management because you don't know my network and you don't know what's happening, and I'm the only one who can really decide what is reasonable traffic management. How do you respond to that?
Well, again, I think I just like to quote them back to themselves, because the debate in the US used to be, we need to manage traffic because we can't handle the capacity. And eventually you saw the biggest cable companies and others joining them, even wireless companies, although it's a little bit more realistic discussion on wireless, saying, yeah, you know, that wasn't really the reason. You're right. We wanted to make more money. That's why we have data caps, but we actually can handle the traffic. And so you see not just 5G, but the development, the cable plant we have in the US is very robust. It's not quite as shiny as fiber all the way to the premises, but there's a lot of fiber in the cable network. And so once these companies, I think, realized that they couldn't tell their investors everything was going great and yet still come to Washington with a straight face and say they were really put upon, they changed their argument. They started to make more of the "it's my network, I should be able to do what I want" argument rather than any kind of technical attempt to legitimize the traffic management.
The exact same thing happened in Canada. In 2009, all the articles, all the media coverage was about network congestion and limited resources. And then suddenly last year in 2016, companies were coming in saying, I don't know what these consumer advocates are talking about. It's not about network congestion, it's a marketing technique. It's about consumer choice. So that was really interesting. The second thing, though, in response to, well, how can you tell us when we're telling you our networks like this, our response would have been, well, show us, put the evidence on the public record, show us and show the regulators that you physically cannot handle this because it's not there. And so that would be the next level of response.
Yeah, I mean, what we need is more transparency at the end. I think a core problem of this debate is that one of the most strongly guarded secrets of an ISP is their real network capacity. So usually you never know what the network could handle, although of course it's known. That's why we all need to be a little bit more aware of the topic of network measurement. We definitely need to become more aware of the traffic management that's actually happening in the networks. Barrick has a responsibility here to come up with measurement tools. I hope they build on existing open source tools. This is also heavily important now in the US because we need to be able to compare what is happening if the new administration really strips the rules. At the end, it's the international perspective of this panel which is the most valuable, because I remember when our previous digital commissioner Günther Oettinger always said that we need specialized services for self-driving cars, which is kind of weird because they drive through tunnels in which they have no mobile reception. Or we need specialized services for remote surgery. And I remember communication of the White House under the Obama administration, which says, now with 5G we can do remote surgery. And it's most of these arguments really fall apart if you look closer.
India is the similar debate. We are having this debate, and when the conversations happen, it's like the network doesn't have enough capacity and we have to do this. And I think the arguments are similar. They're taken from like the US or the European debate, and like what everyone's saying the same thing. They are like, show us the data. There should be more transparency and stuff. And I guess what's useful in the Indian context, and as you said, is like we have learned so much like from the other debates that have already happened, and that has really helped in the entire the movement that has.
Okay, well, I'd also sort of, we touched on it at the beginning, but sort of coming back full circle, I want to ask particularly you, Matt, about the Trump administration and what sort of effects you predict for the next couple of years. And I'm going to finish off by asking you all for a couple of predictions just to wrap up.
I think I can predict with certainty that there's great uncertainty. It's just, I mean, I was at the previous panels in this room and they were talking about populism and just what a messy and undefined term that's become. But understanding the perils of using it, there is this populist streak to what he's talked about, and so I'll wind up talking about mergers in the US again, but they affect people around the world. The AT&T Time Warner merger, currently under debate and under review, where AT&T would buy not the cable company, but the company that owns CNN and HBO and companies that have a worldwide media distribution footprint. Trump said when that was announced in October as a candidate, I would never allow this to happen. I would block this. He actually had a 2-page position paper written on it, and we looked at it and we said, this kind of looks like 1/3 locker up and 2/3 a Free Press press release from 10 years ago. It was all about the evils of media consolidation. So I don't really expect him to deliver on those promises, and the people he's appointed to these jobs are not delivering on them. I mean, they are today caving in to incumbent and monopolist demands. But I don't think there's any easy way to say, as I started out by saying, you know, that all the Republican opposition to this is actually aligned with one another. And so just how and how successful they will be, I guess my final point is I come here with some optimism. I think that as the healthcare collapse last week shows, you know, it's a lot different to promise you'll do something than it is to actually carry it out once you have the levers of power. And so I don't know how they'll try to do it, but I think that, you know, there is room to fight back and that it's not necessarily all over for us for the next 8 years.
Oh, 8?
Yeah, right.
Julie, your predictions for the markets you're looking at? Or more broadly, if you want.
Yes, predictions. I'm afraid if things continue the way they do, I mean, it won't be an issue. It risks not being an issue. Preoccupation on net neutrality risks not being an issue for many governments and citizens. But a lot of hope as well, because since the debate is reheating in the US and other northern countries and the EU as well, it will certainly, you know, influence. There are links, political links between a lot of countries in West and Central Africa specifically, which I know very well, and the EU, for instance. So I'm sure even in political discussions, these are the things that should come out as well, come up. And as I was saying, most importantly, what is urgent now when it comes to the African market, it's the next frontier, not only for the markets, but it should also be the next frontier for civil society and for digital rights awareness. And that's where I think we here as a community have a role, and a very important role to play.
Okay, Cynthia?
Okay, I think from Canada's perspective, we probably feel a little bit more pressure now to hold the floor just with what's going on down south. So a lot of our messaging will be, well, this is going south in the States, so it's even more important now that we keep it up in Canada. We were feeling hopeful last year with the regulator's response throughout mm-hmm. the zero rating hearing, and I think we're still hopeful at the end of the day, of course, even though things are a little bit more have the potential to become more destabilized again, what with the review that was announced in the budget. But because they have been trying to be more consumer friendly ostensibly, and we're trying to hold them to that in substance, I think at the end of the day, our general feeling is it's going to be a lot of hard work, but we can do it.
Sanjeev?
In India, again, I think for the next year or year and a half, I think the regulator will come up with the entire regulations, and I think we'll actually have to push them back quite a bit. And the only way, at least in India, that I see is to have the awareness that we generated, because like in a country like India, where there are a lot of what you can say are immediate needs, people don't really understand why it's important. So I think just pushing them back, and to also make sure that we use the examples from other countries, that I think will be useful.
I can just build on what Cynthia says. There is a little bit more weight on our shoulders to keep up the neutrality in those regions of the world where we have protections, and also to keep on showing how net neutrality is good for consumers, for fundamental rights, and also for competition and innovation. I think in the international collaboration and comparison, we can make our case best. Yeah, even though the fight is not over in most parts of the world, we cannot afford to lose it, because we have this global trend in the internet to centralize data pools, to centralize power structures and create dependencies. And if we would ever lose that on the network level, then I think we've lost.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you all for being here. And I really do encourage you, go and find that video. It's really worth watching, and it will help you spread the message of what net neutrality is to people who aren't at RightsCon and who don't get it. Okay, and so a big round of applause for our panelists. Thank you.